Hi guys, thank you very much for coming back to the channel. This is Lee from TheRamblerz speaking, and today we're going to be taking a look at the first of what I hope will be a long new series of what we're calling flashbacks. Now, what is a flashback, you may ask? A flashback is going to be similar to the spotlight videos that we're already putting out, and it's basically a first impression style video, but they will be focused on games that are older than 10 years. It's essentially going to be focusing on games that are a lot older and possibly not got the awareness that we would like them to have. Now, I'm doing this because I don't necessarily feel that modern games are the be-all and end-all and that what people should necessarily be focusing on. A lot of people have the tendency to focus on whatever is new and shiny at the time, and a lot of excellent classic games get lost in the sort of wayside. So what we're actually going to be doing is setting up a series of videos that will focus on some of those older games, some of them that I know of, some of them you may know of, and some of them that I have absolutely no idea about and be learning about myself as we go through, much like we do with the Spotlight videos. The format of them was actually going to change slightly. Spotlight videos generally focus on like the initial sort of 15-20 minutes of gameplay or until we have a general idea of what the game's going to be like. The flashbacks, will also set as an example for future Spotlight templates, are going to focus on like the first 10-15 minutes of gameplay and will then cut into about 3-4 hours in the future worth of gameplay, so we can see how the game is like from the middle to long term to see whether it's worth playing over the long term. So essentially, a lot of the reason that older games are actually ignored for the most part are sort of based on, essentially, let's face it, it's based on graphics. Some games do look pretty terrible. They may have a really nice aesthetic, a really nice art style, but if the resolutions, what have you, is quite low, a lot of people will automatically write them off. That's something I necessarily want to address now. So when it comes to actually previewing or reviewing these games, I'm not going to be looking at the graphical fidelity. I will be looking at the art style, and I will be looking at the gameplay more specifically. When it comes to graphic technicalities, I may remark on them occasionally as to how they actually play on a modern computer. For instance, the monitors we play on now are a lot bigger than the ones that may have been available back then. For instance, I'm actually playing on a 24-inch monitor. I think the largest monitors that may have been available back then were like 19-inch or something. This is widescreen. The CRTs back then were square. And we're using a 4:3 ratio as opposed to 16:9. So obviously, I'm going to be talking necessarily about how the game may impact on those higher resolutions, or at least on those higher ratios, and anything that may actually negatively or positively affect them from there. Okay, we're also going to be looking at how the game stands to play now. I'm not interested in how the game played 10 years ago or what revolutions they may necessarily have brought to the genres back then. I want to know how they play now and how they compare to modern counterparts. Because let's face it, when you play a game, you're not thinking about, hey, this is crap, but it played amazingly 15 years ago. You're actually wanting to know how it plays now and how enjoyable it is. Because let's face it, modern games have given us certain expectations. And I think a lot of old games do actually meet or even at times surpass those expectations in their own way, so we're going to be taking a look at those. There's going to be no rose-tinted glasses, it's just going to be a frank appraisal of how the game actually plays now. Okay, so what we're actually going to be looking at as well is games that can actually be played now, so they will be patched up to the current modern level. So we won't be playing just as it's installed off the disc as it was available in 1999 when it was released. In the case of Age of Empires 2, we'll be installing all of the patches that are available and released officially. I know that a lot of games have unofficial patches that may actually help things out a little bit there, but some of them can be fairly difficult to find, and I just want to stick to how the game was let officially from the developers at the time. There will be also no expansions installed, and there will be no mods installed. A lot of games obviously have a big modding scene that helps out with the longevity, but some of them are so varied and change the game so much it's difficult to actually give a good example of how the game should play. So we'll just be sticking with the baseline game and have that patched. Now, the game we're actually starting with is Age of Empires 2. Many of you know that, and that is a deliberate choice on my part. I want to start off with a game that a lot of people already have an idea of, just so you can compare your opinions of the game and any ideas you have fit in your mind with what I actually say in the video. Not only will it give you an opportunity to reconsider how the game actually plays and maybe go back to it later, but it also allows you to compare your expectations with how I portray the game, and let you know whether you're actually going to fit in with how I actually put out the videos. So let's hopefully that will actually continue on with that one. So Age of Empires 2, what is it? Age of Empires 2 is a mishmash of empire or nation building, much like you find in Civilization style games. Civilization 2, I think, was out at that time, and mixes that with some of the RTS elements, real-time strategy elements that would have been found from let me see, Dark Reigns, the original StarCraft, some of the Red Alert series, which were also available at the time. And it sort of puts those in together, and it did so very successfully. This was a very, very successful, very popular game. It actually wound up in number one in 7 countries. From my statistics I looked up, it actually stayed in the charts. It was in the top 20 for 2.5-3 years in many countries after release, and was one of the most widely sold games at the time. So, whilst obviously we're going to take that into account in our appraisal, it was very, very popular at the time and was obviously held in very high esteem. So we'll take a look at the options in the front menu as we always do. Learn to Play is a tutorial, and it's actually, the tutorial is a campaign in itself. Now, the game has 5 campaigns, one of which does include the tutorial. This one obviously starts you off with marching and fighting. Now, the tutorials themselves are all setting context to the actual storyline, which actually does help. It does take the edge off, because some of the campaigns, some of the tutorial rounds are pretty much no-brainers. Marching and fighting is all about moving, and it literally has you moving between flag posts. But it does set the whole thing in context of storyline, which does actually help get you through it, and makes the tedium of moving between flagpoles seem a little bit less. So you've got moving, you've got resource gathering and feeding, you have training troops and building barracks and what have you, we have research and technology and how to upgrade units and villages, and then that all comes together for the first time in the Battle of Stirling, where you will build your first barracks and your villages and start resource gathering and build that all into one and to complete your first objectives, and then that carries on to the end of the storyline. Okay, so we'll come back to that in a moment. Now, what you actually find is when you get to the menu, you actually have single player and multiplayer. Now, we will be focusing on the single player for this one, not least because not many people are playing this on multiplayer anymore. And to be frank, when I was actually playing this way back when, setting up a multiplayer in this game was a serious pain in the ass. I really cannot emphasize that enough. Multiplayer was not necessarily easy to set up. Peer-to-peer multiplayer was easier to set up than going to the MSN gaming zone, which was awful. There were no dedicated servers or anything along those lines. Saying that, multiplayer was actually fun when you got up there. Most of the time it was actually played in LAN, and it does support up to 8 people if you want to get friends and what have you to play into that. I do recommend it. You have a map editor. Map editor is very, very cool. I never really played around with it that much, though some of my friends did. They set up their own maps, which we'd all jump in on for multiplayer games, or you can just set up deathmatch style games against the computer to test them out. And it's good fun. It did help with the longevity of the game a little. Now you have history. The history, it gives you literally a little bit of context for each of the nations you're able to play. Now, there are 13 nations available for the game. Britons, Byzantines, Celts, down to the Teutons, the Turks, and the Vikings. And it just basically, it's here just to give set some historical context to the races you're playing. It doesn't give any of the strategic elements that each of the races brings to the game, which is a shame, because you don't actually get to know anything more about that until later on. For instance, let me see, with the Goths, just off the top of my head. The Goths, for instance, had issues with defence in the actual game. For instance, they had some quite strong units and they were able to gather things quite quickly. However, saying that, they weren't able to build walls, towers, etc. to any great extent, meaning they were on the back foot as far as defence. Their villages and towns, what have you, were left wide open. And so you actually had to take that into account when trying to defend your village from attacks from various fronts. The Japanese, for instance, they had difficulties with resource gathering in the late game. They weren't able to use improved mining or improved agricultural farming or anything along those lines. They had some awesomely strong units in the late game, stronger than some of the other nations, but they had difficulties gathering that wealth to churn them out to any great number. So if they had stronger units, that was balanced out by the fact that they couldn't get the numbers together in the later game. It also meant that you had to be fairly vicious in the early game to try and sort of stay on top. Each of the nations do have their own specific units. They have one unit each, which sort of differentiates them. For instance, the Britons had longbow. It's essentially, as you probably well know, an archer, which could, with greater range and greater power. The Byzantines have greater siege capability. The Celts have woad riders. This little dude down here is basically a stronger melee unit, stronger defence, stronger attack. It sort of goes on all the way down. Saracen gets camels, I believe, if I can get additional Silas ships there. So pros and cons there, excellent historical context, but we would have liked a little bit more information there on what the various races bring into the game when you're actually playing them. Now, the options, very simplistic. You're able to set up your own profiles, which in turn have their own hotkeys set up. So if you go into the hotkeys, you can set a hotkey for your villagers, archery range. Now, each of the buildings you build already have their preset hotkeys to bounce around to automatically build things more quickly, which is very good. And you'll actually find that in modern equivalents such as StarCraft and what have you, where you actually have to assign hotkeys to the various buildings as you go through, or at least I do at any rate, to obviously make sure that your APM is nice and high, actions per minute that is, which can be fairly important to ensuring that you aren't falling behind. And there are quite a few of them to memorise there, or you can just reset them. Okay, you also have your screen size. Highest resolution is 1280 by 1024, which is fairly low by modern standards, and that does impact on the size of the monitor I'm running on. It does look quite stretched, which is a bit of a shame, but we'll come to that later. You've got your music volume, you've got your scrolling speeds even, and your graphical detail. High graphical detail doesn't mean much, unfortunately, to this. It does look quite poor, but there you go, it's an old game. Okay, so what we'll actually do for the timing is I'm actually, just to give you a general idea of what it looks like at first, I'm actually just going to jump into the Battle of Stirling in the training campaign. Time for minor skirmishes is over. Okay, so this is the cutscenes that you'll actually find as you go through. Now, some of them do have actual motion capture cutscenes. However, this is starts off with just images with a little bit of a voiceover. Now, as you can probably tell from the voiceover, the accents are absolutely dreadful. However, they do set some context and some storylines and set out some of your objectives as you go through. Okay, we'll skip past those and we'll head straight in. Now, this is what you'll actually be presented with first. Your objective in the campaign that you're doing at the time, defeat the English army and destroy their tower. It's a pretty specific objective, let's face it. That's pretty whole-encompassing. And you get your hints. Begins in a similar way to random map games. After you play a scenario, you should know you need to play a random map game. So it's double-barreled for this one. It helps us give you an idea of what you can expect from the campaigns, but also what to expect from the random map games when we go. And keep exploring. Okay. So you have a little bit of blurb in a moment. There you go. It'll tell you what it needs to do and sets more historical context. But I think what we'll do for the moment is just to...
We can defeat the English here.
Turn that off for the second, or at least turn that down just while I'm actually talking. So what we actually have is what you'll actually expect to see in a random map game and for a lot of the campaign modules as we go through. You have your town village centre just here. This is where you produce your villagers, and the villagers are responsible for gathering in terms of gold production, mining stone, cutting down and chopping up wood, and farming food or gathering or harvesting from various animals that you can actually find around. Now, if I actually click on the villager here, they're also responsible for building various structures. Now, if we actually send that over here to gather berries, that will actually add to our food production, which you can find just up here. If I click on the person here, send over for wood, I'll gather over our wood production up here. And if I can go up to here, I'll actually get this guy to build a house. Now, you actually find from the top here, you have your population. Now, the population is literally the number of units, both in terms of villagers and military-style units that you can have any one time. It's actually starts with a fairly low cap, and you raise that cap by building houses. Okay, which you get from villagers. Now, this is a scout, a cavalry-style unit. I'll actually turn that off for the moment. And essentially, this is... a slightly faster moving unit with, apparently it has a really good range of eyesight, but let's face it, if you're standing here and you can't see these trees from here, then I would seriously be looking at getting my scout to Specsavers pronto, because he's not actually going to see a great deal. Now, as you actually go around, you'll discover more resources. We actually found some stone just here, and we've also found some sheep. Now, my scout has powerful mind control sheep elements in that he can actually find sheep and then make them automatically walk over to the slaughter at the village. Now, these actually become units that don't address your cap in any way, shape or form, but you can walk them over and you can actually have them around ready to be slaughtered. Now, if we go to the village, we can create more units. We actually create a couple of them. And we actually have this guy here that's now not building anything, which actually just brings us to another point. If we just go to my... scout up here, send him over. We can actually set off waypoints and he'll follow those along as we go. So we actually have a button down here which is actually pretty useful, and I think more RTSs should actually be making use of this. Now obviously StarCraft does, StarCraft 2 even does, but a lot of modern RTSs even still miss this one. Click on it and it will automatically take you to any villagers that are literally standing idle really hugely important on that one I think, because it actually does help out a lot to knowing if you're actually missing any potential income from resources. Now you'll actually go up and you'll start hacking that sheep to bits, and the other ones won't actually mind, you know, just chill out, son, watching me brother get slaughtered, all good. We'll send this one up here to start farming off the berries. Now what we actually want to do first of all is come up to here and build a mill. Now a mill will actually operate as a remote area for gathering resources. If I build that here, anything around here will automatically churn or channel the resources into the mill. Otherwise they'll just take it to the town centre, but they will automatically take it to whichever is closest. Now you can actually request that they take them straight back to the town centre as opposed to the mill if you wanted to, literally by just highlighting that and clicking on the building. So you do have an element of freedom there as to where you actually want those to go. So let's just actually see if we can just get this guy to walk around a lot. Would be nice. Okay, so we'll actually continue building these. And we'll actually take you now, finishing them. Now, as you see from the mill at the moment, there are no upgrades or anything available. It's just the building, and these would automatically switch into, there you go, taking it to the mill as requested. Now, we'll actually bring you down here. We'll actually go and find some water, which I just happen to know is down here. I'm actually going to get this little lady here to build a lumber mill, and we'll actually start sending all of our tree people to build those here. Now, you can obviously then build a dock just on the edge there, and you can actually start building fishing boats. And again, you can actually get your gathering resources in terms of food from fishing boats from the middle of the water there, so you actually have plenty of options. The dock will also be able to build combat ships and troop galleys, so you can move things around a little bit more easily. Now you can set waypoints if you wanted to. You can set them so that anything that is built will automatically go and farm, for instance, so you can do that. I'll actually have you come down here and start having you build here. Now, on the village centre here, what we actually have is upgrades. Now, when you actually get to the second age, all buildings will be able to build specific upgrades to make your villagers, your increase the effectiveness of your military units and what have you, for set amounts of gold, wood, food, etc. And here you'd actually see advanced feudal age. Now, when you actually get to this particular aspect of time in the game, you actually get to a point where you can't really build anything more. You're actually making up resources, and you may want to increase or advance your nation to the next age. And when that actually happens, you'll find that you will the images, the actual art style of the buildings will change completely, and you'll have more options from preset buildings that you've already built in terms of the troops that are available, the upgrades that are available, and any additional options that may be helpful at the time. Actually, build a fishing ship just here, why not? Okay, so as you can tell, this aim is actually a little bit slow when it comes to doing that. However, you can actually speed that up. So if we go to the options menu, and we can actually set that to... Oh no, we can't actually set that to fast at the moment. That is a little bit of a shame. On normal games, you'll actually be able to change the speed of the game, and you're able to set it to fast, so you won't actually have quite so much downtime when it actually comes to that. Okay, so this is actually literally just the basics of the game right here. Okay, see if we can actually bring you around. Now, you actually tell from the art style, especially with the size of the monitor here, it does actually look a little bit stretched. You've actually lost a little bit of the detail on some of the units. I actually find that with the units themselves, they will pretty much look the same depending on the nations that you go for. They're actually split into four broad categories. You've got Western Europe, which takes into account Scotland, England, France, and what have you. You got Central Europe, which is like the Holy Roman Empire, Byzantine sort of areas. You then got the Eurasian area, like Genghis Khan and Russia. And you then got the Middle Eastern areas, such as, I think, Persia and what have you. I think it's Persia, it might be Iraq. Those kind of areas, those sort of Middle Eastern areas. They all have different units to like the different quadrants, but each of the quadrants, depending on the nation, disregarding the nation you actually go for, all have similar looking units. If in an AI game, say you've got England facing off against France, for instance, sort of pulling on a stereotype there, you'll actually find that the units would all look the same, you'll just have different colours, which can be a little bit confusing at times. It would have been nice to have a little bit more detail on the units there, but considering the age of the game, it's not entirely surprising that it isn't. Now, the game itself is obviously incredibly simplistic. Let's just take a look here at the interface itself. You've got the button here to actually show you any units that aren't actually doing anything at the time that you can set to work, and we'll set them over there. Actually, we'll probably set you to build a house where we just reached our cap. We have the help on or off, and we have turn on advanced settings. Now, when it comes to here, you've actually got your different buildings. You've got your lumber mill or your windmill that we actually got here. When you actually upgrade into the sort of feudal age and beyond, the buildings will actually advance as well. They actually become a fully fledged windmill. You've got your mining camp and dock. You can also build farms. So we'll actually show you that a bit later on. You also build your barracks, watchtowers and fences. And that's pretty much it from that point of view. Now, when you actually turn on the advanced commands, when you're actually a little bit more comfortable with the game, you actually got your standard patrol. Now, we can actually set this guy to patrol. So if we order the units here and I actually go to patrol here, he will patrol from his starting point to the position that we've actually entered for him, and it'll generally go round in a little bit of a circle. So you can, if you're actually trying to look around or trying to guard off against an area without wanting to put too much attention on it, just take a unit or two, set them off, and just have them patrolling over an area. Guard, if you want to guard to a unit to protect a specific unit, specific building, specific relic, I'll get onto those later. You can just select that one and it'll automatically guard that one, so you don't have to focus so much attention. Again, follow is pretty obvious. Kill your unit if you want to get rid of some villagers, you think you have too many of them, or you want to reorganise your military units to gear them to a different type of combat, you can just kill them off. You then got stop, no attackers, you stand ground, etc, etc. So that's pretty much it from there. Then we see you also have statistics on when you're actually facing off against different units. You've got different scores. Now, whilst it won't actually tell you how well they're doing per se, it will give you a general idea of what it is that they are, obviously a general idea of how strong they necessarily are. So at the moment we have a higher score, so our economy may be doing slightly better. We may have more military units, and you know, just gives you a general idea there. Now, we actually have a look down here, just because of the lack of the fidelity that we actually have here, it can be quite difficult to see the fish jumping around. I actually have to look quite closely for those. It's not necessarily intuitive when you're actually going around. It sometimes might be necessary just to click around to see where it will actually tell you where the actual fish themselves actually are. It's a little bit annoying. You do actually have to look out for that, but the gameplay itself is not really hindered by that. It's just something you have to look out for. Now, I actually have enough food to actually take us up to the next stage. Now, this would actually be normally done quite late, a lot later, but just to give you a general idea of what's actually happening here. So we have 10% there. So we actually finished our barracks. So we'll actually send him off over there, and we'll start building up some units. Now, as you can tell, these units actually look pretty much to how they would appear in the game at the completion. So just build that up there. Here we go. So as you can... Oh, we actually have units. That's not so good. Right, so this is actually a good opportunity to show you something else in the game. Now, the villagers are not just resource gatherers. If you hit this bell here, all of the villagers will automatically go into the town centre, and they will automatically start defending. They will start shooting. Now, obviously, the arrows are a little bit strange. You expect to be shooting out from the middle, but they're actually shooting from outside the village, which is a little bit on the weird side. However, it does make the villagers something more than just resource gatherers that you build, assign to their tasks, and ignore for the rest of the game. They do have defensive capabilities. Now, we've actually beaten off the English attack successfully, down the English, and we'll just send the villagers back to work at the easy click of a button. So it's actually nice and easy there, and it does add a little bit of a dynamic. Now, the villagers do actually have more of a role as you actually go through the game. For instance, you can have them set as sappers. You can actually train them to attack other buildings if you can't get siege engines or any other sort of battering rams, etc., built up in time. You can also... There we go, there's the change of the age there. They also do have the capability to attack other units. Admittedly, their hit points are lower and the amount of damage they're able to put out is lower, but they can be cannon fodder or anything else that you actually want them to be later in the game. So it is actually quite nice from that perspective. Just adds a little bit of an element to that. I mean, that's something you don't really find these days in modern RTSs. StarCraft 2, for instance, you have your drones or what have you, which can gather resources, or you can use them as cannon fodder or to actually rush people. But that's pretty much the extent. That's all that they do. Just the versatility you actually have with that, and you're able to train your villagers to do something else, I consider to be a big plus. I quite like that. It's good. So this is actually it that I can actually show for the basic game. Obviously, you'd carry on. Obviously, now we actually built the sort of gone up an age. We have different options available at our barracks. We're actually able to build other buildings now. We can build the stable. We can build gates. We can build walls. We can build brick towers. We have an archery that is actually available to us. We also now build blacksmiths. A market where you can actually, if you have obviously have a massive surplus of resources, you can just trade those in for other resources at a cost, or just sell them outright for more gold, which is important. We have farms, etc., that we can actually build. Now, the farms that we actually built them, obviously they will farm them for increased food. You can then upgrade. So obviously, farm produces an additional 75 food and lasts longer. Now, the farms themselves have a set life. You can't just build them and leave them there for the rest of the game. After a while, they will actually just die off. If you actually have a look there, it actually gives you the amount of food that it's actually able to get. They also have hit points, so they can be destroyed. So if you're playing against AI or against any sort of friends, etc., and you want to curtail their resource gathering, you can actually destroy their farms, or you can just wait for them to run out. Once they've run out, they will actually then go fally, the graphic will change, and you'll then have to wait until such a time as you can rebuild them. They don't cost very much, it's pretty easy to do. Alright, what we actually have here now is further upgrades. Now, yeah, military buildings will have these as well. It's quite cool. You can increase military hit points, the damage they can do, the speed that they run, or you can actually increase the efficiency of the workers, make them move faster, carry more resources, and obviously when you actually decide to buy these upgrades, will actually weigh on balance. Obviously, some of them are quite expensive, so if you're spending quite a lot on food, then you're not being able to build more troops, but it's going to be better in the long run, so you have to balance that against the need for immediate troops or a lot more long-term game plan. Obviously, our horsey is actually still moving around quite a lot there. So what we're actually going to do is, this is actually the basics of the game. I've covered the basics quite nicely. It is incredibly simple. Easy to run, difficult, not say difficult to master, but certainly harder. There are certainly tactics in there that you may have issue with. So what we'll actually do is we'll cut away now, and I'll cut back in to a game where I've actually been playing for a few hours, and it will give you a general idea of what the game is like in the mid to late term. So I'll see you in a second.